Meanwhile,
the death toll rising again in Japan now. Officially, it's 51. No doubt that will continue to rise, unfortunately. Joining us right now from Tokyo is Yumiko Ono. She's the managing editor of WallStreetJournal.com in Japan. Good morning to you, or I guess it's 14-hour time difference between New York City and Tokyo where you are. So tell us where you are and what your situation is. Do you have power, and what is around you?
Yeah, well, we do have everything right now. You know, it's now about 9 p.m. Tokyo time. I'm right in the middle of central Tokyo on the 19th floor of an office building. When the quake struck, this was mid-afternoon for us, and we first had this up-and-down movement, you know, as if somebody was poking us with a stick from underneath the ground. And then there was huge swaying side by side for what felt like way over a minute. There was no damage in our office, but now we're seeing live footage of, you know, broken windows, even in Tokyo. We're hundreds of miles away from the epicenter, but even here, the quake was quite strong.
How's the communication been between government officials, local and federal, and the people?
Yeah, well, first of all, for the people, it's very difficult to get a phone line to connect to anybody within Tokyo or within Japan. We're all trying to call our families with mixed luck. I've been able to get through finally, but it took quite a few tries.
Yeah.
The government, the prime minister, held an emergency press conference very soon after the earthquake. He seemed quite prepared in that sense, and now he's considered, you know, trying to figure out which local officials need aid and military assistance.
Mm-hmm. Yumiko, this is the biggest earthquake in the history mm-hmm. of Japan, and I know you've seen the images.
Mm-hmm.
There's never been a tsunami wave in recorded history like this. When you see these pictures of that 30-foot wave go over the north shore of your country, what do you think?
Yeah. It's really, really frightening. I mean, I've been in Japan for over 30 years, but this is the first time that I felt such a huge earthquake to start with. And you're absolutely right with the tsunami. I mean, there are whole houses being swept away by the water. We've been watching live footage on TV in our office, and you're seeing a whole ship kind of, you know, bashing against the bridge.
Right.
I've never seen anything like that in my country.
Are you scared?
It's quite frightening, actually. It really is quite frightening. I mean, there was a little bit of a panic within our office when the quake just would not stop.
What floor?
And the aftershocks. Hmm?
What floor?
We're on the 19th floor.
Yeah.
And also, there are aftershocks, first every few minutes and now every now and then. Right before I'm talking to you guys, there was another swaying an hour after the earthquake. There was quite a bit of rattling, and right by the windows, the blinds would rattle against the window, so it's quite frightening.
So let me ask you this. Why are you staying on the 19th floor?
You know, for a while, that's a very good question. The trains have all stopped.
Uh-huh.
It's very difficult to get home. You know, I live about 45 minutes away by train. If I try walking, it's going to be hours. And with the coverage, you know, we're in the news business, so we have to stay and cover the story. However, all over Tokyo, there are commuters who are trying to figure out how they're going to get home. All over the major train stations, there's a huge crowd of people. We had a reporter go out and talk to these people and found that some people were trying to purchase bicycles so that they could ride their bikes home.
Well, that makes sense, because they really have no other choice.
Yeah, absolutely.
But the question is, what do they know if they get home? They don't even know what they have.
Absolutely. But I don't think the damage is that bad in their homes. You know, one of the reasons why this, right, one of the reasons why this building swayed so much is because it's earthquake-proofed.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the ways it's being earthquake-proofed is it sways a lot, so it lets the energy out, the built-up energy. So, you know, us being on the 19th floor, it keeps swaying back and forth for a few minutes even after the earthquake has stopped.
So that's why the authorities are not telling you you have to leave. Is that why?
I'm not sure why they're not telling us to leave. It may also be because Tokyo is so far away from the epicenter,
mm-hmm.
and even if the swaying was you know, it was quite large, it's not the same thing as being right there in the middle of it all.
Sure.
Now, there's very little information from the local area that's been hit the hardest, and it's very difficult to get there right now. So I'm sure that as time goes on and more information arises, there's going to be more footage of what kind of damage there's been. You know, there's some factories out there,
right,
tech factories and auto parts factories. So we're still waiting to really see for ourselves how bad the damage was.
And as somebody who does the Wall Street Journal, is counted on by so many, especially even in Japan now, what do you see your role in terms of dispatching reporters? Where are you going to focus?
Well, I mean, there's so many things to focus on. We really have to ask ourselves, what is the impact on the economy? The Japanese economy has been stagnant for such a long time. We've seen nascent signs of recovery, but is this going to, you know, damage the economy again? We also have to think about whenever there's reconstruction efforts, that's going to add to the debt of the country. In Japan already, whoa, here's swaying again, aftershocks. Whenever there's reconstruction, that's going to add to the debt. And Japan already has 200% of GDP as debt. So it's one of the most highly indebted countries. Yeah. So this cannot be good for the country. I'm also watching closely to see how the prime minister does in dealing with this. I mean, he is under a lot of political pressure right now to resign. Just this morning, there was another scandal around him. His foreign minister had to quit just this week. So he's, you know, things are not looking good for him, and this is a true test to see how much leadership he can really, you know, show us.